The sound of jazz, the sound of men communicating with each other and with you. Communicating in a new kind of way, well, as new as this century of ours. Jazz has come to mean a great deal to us in that short time, and to mean a lot of different things to a lot of different people. It's a youthful music, a sort of mirror held up to our most lighthearted moments. It's Dixieland and Chicago and the great bands of the swing era. It's the music that you dance to on your first big date. It's all these things and more. What do you remember best? A spring evening at the Glen Island Casino or the Palomar? A crowded Saturday night on 52nd Street or maybe a Sunday afternoon at the Lighthouse Cafe? To a lot of people, it was the summer of 1952. And a small supper club across the street from the Coconut Grove. Inside, four young men are taking their place in the bandstand. The drummer thoughtfully weighs his stick, his right foot finds a pedal, and a muffled thump distracts a couple at the bar. The bassist bows impatiently, and the trumpeter, looking for all the world like a high school senior, moistens his mouthpiece. The leader adjusts the strap that holds a baritone sax, and he motions to the rest. Conversations die. And only the soft whir of a cocktail mixer competes for attention. That was a hot Thursday night in July. These men were unknown then, just beginning to find an identity. Of the four, three went on to international fame. The leader, Jerry Mulligan, was hailed as one of the most influential individualists in jazz. Chet Baker rose from complete obscurity to the nation's most popular trumpeter. The drummer, Chico Hamilton, later became the leader of the most widely acclaimed quintet to emerge in 1955. But what's more important than the personal successes these men achieved is the fact that they and the others that were active that summer triggered a jazz revival so immense that in the years that followed, jazz was to find the broadest patronage in its history. It was to make this new music available to an international audience that Pacific Jazz was formed later that same summer. What follows is in the way of a musical guided tour through the highlights of the Pacific Jazz recordings that resulted, all of which are available today on high quality, high fidelity, long playing 12-inch albums.
Thank you.
While the Mulligan Quartet was packing the customers in at the Hague Club, 15 miles southwest of Los Angeles at the resort town of Hermosa Beach, another group was enjoying a similar degree of acceptance. And there at the Lighthouse Cafe, Howard Rumsey had gathered together a first-rate group that would, in a year's time, be one of the best-known jazz organizations in the world. A great part of that group's original style came from the writing and playing of its trumpeter, Shorty Rogers. Here's Rogers and another young musician who was destined to reach the top ranks, alto saxist Bud Shank. When Chet Baker swept both the metronome and the downbeat poles, it was inevitable that he should step out on his own. His first group was a quartet. A highly productive group that found success on record as well as in club and concert. Of immense importance to the quartet's success was the articulate playing and imaginative compositions of its pianist, Russ Freeman. And here's Freeman's original, No Ties. Early in 1954, it was decided to showcase Chet on record in a different way. In the spring of that year, the Chet Baker Ensemble appeared and found an immediate audience. This served not only to place Baker before a new backdrop, but to introduce the ruggedly individual concepts of Jack Montrose, who arranged the material and composed this tune, Bacchanal. Several months later, Chet's expanding audience found that he could sing. And a whole new facet of his talent was revealed. By the end of the year, Chet Baker was placing high on the popularity polls alongside of the nation's top singers.
Shadows pass my window, dark and lonely forms, memories of a fire become an ember, gray December, listen, can't you hear it? Sighs and listless tread, shapeless dreams I try hard to remember. Gray December. Couldn't you...
In the fall of 1954, Baker assembled a sextet. And he recorded an original tune by Johnny Mandel, one of the most important arranger composers in the field of jazz. Here is Mandel's exciting Tommy Hawk. While Baker and Mulligan were establishing themselves as major attractions, Bud Shank was finding a following, too. In the summer of 1953, he signed an exclusive Pacific Jazz recording contract. The first album to reach the market was a subtle and graceful merger of Brazilian guitar and Yankee alto sax, as concert guitarist Laurindo Almeida and Bud Shank intermixed their musical language. In 1954, Bud Shank received Metronome Magazine's coveted New Star Award. By 1955, he was placing high on the popularity polls, not only as an altoist, but as a flutist. In January 1956, Bud formed a quartet that featured pianist Claude Williamson. On the 19th of that month, The quartet recorded Williamson's haunting Nocturne for Flute. When Chet Baker went to Europe in September of 1955, he took with him a startling new pianist from Boston named Richard Twardzik. Twardzik died in Paris a few months later, depriving us all of the great ability that was his. Here's the late Richard Twardzik as he sounded in 1954, playing his own composition, A Crutch for the Crab. During the first few years of the 50s, tenor saxist Bill Perkins was busy playing with the bands of Woody Herman and Stan Kenton. By 1950, soloist. Early that year, Perkins recorded with Bud Shank, and at year's end was named New Star of 1955 by Metronome. A man of broad musical moods, Bill Perkins combines a great warmth and lyrical quality with a rare rhythmic drive. And here he is, supported by pianist John Lewis. Thank you. In April of 1955, Chico Hamilton, who'd not been heard from extensively since his work with the Mulligan Quartet, took a quintet into a Long Beach, California nightclub, and in 3 months' time had shaped it into the most provocative new group to come out of the West Coast in 3 years. Pacific Jazz recorded that quintet, and it became an immediate sensation. The quintet's most fascinating feature is the remarkable musical intuition that ties the five men together as though mentally united. And here's an example of that, appropriately entitled, Free Form. The sound of jazz. The sound of men improvising. Exciting, subtle, warm. A music without boundaries. A medium of emotional and intellectual communication unlike anything else in the world of music. The growth of Pacific Jazz and the men who came into prominence under its banner is a representative paragraph in the larger story that is jazz. An exciting paragraph in the story of productive and highly individual men with an unshakable belief in America's own music. This is just the beginning.
Voici Jerry Mulligan Quartet. Thank you.
Thank you.
Look for the silver lining whene'er a cloud appears in the blue. Remember somewhere the sun is shining, and so the right thing to do is make it shine for you, a heart full of joy and gladness. We'll always banish sadness and strife. So always look for the silver lining and try to find the sunny side of life. Heart full of joy and gladness will always banish sadness and strife. So always look for the silver lining and try to find the sunny side of life. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.